we sing together. Make it. This is that place.
Good morning, everyone. Can everybody hear me? All right. I hope you are all doing well and staying cool in this violent heat that we've been having for the past few days. But I praise the Lord for comfort and AC, so it just feels good to be here at this time. We're going to just start off with a word of prayer. So at this time, let us pray together. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this time where we can come and just worship you, Lord. And we ask for just this opportunity where we can draw closer to you, that we can understand you better, that we can fellowship with one another. And Lord, we are not here by accident, but we are here to serve. We're here to honor, and we're here to worship you, Lord. And for this, we thank you, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, we're just going to go ahead and start off with our first song, I Surrender All.
Thank you.
Psalms 91, verses 1 through 7. And we'll read that together, and it says, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadows of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. Amen. And you may now be seated. And now I will turn the time and attention over to you, where if you have any prayer requests, any praise reports, or any joys and concerns or announcements, the time is now yours. Yes. Yeah, me too. Yeah, so Matt, it's either Matt or Jackie. Okay, it's Matt. Yes. Oh, you should. Please. Should we sing for Jack? You think so?
Yeah.
Fine. All right, hold on. Let's move on. Was there any other prayer requests at this time? All right, and let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are just so thankful that we can just come here into fellowship. Just an outpouring of your Holy Spirit to just come into our hearts, Lord, in these troublesome and indecent and confusing times in which we live. Lord, we need to just draw closer to you. And Lord, and we just pray that we may not be hit with the snares and the fowls that may attack us. Lord, we know that indeed the enemy is on a
That's right. That's right.
Dr. Matt, are you sure you're okay?
And as Paul is writing, then he says, right now there are people that are asleep. Meaning spiritually asleep. Meaning there are people that are not interested in spiritual things, are not interested in God, and they are just asleep at the wheel, and they don't know what's happening. And Paul wrote this, and he's saying, listen, right now, it's the time that we need to wake up. We need to wake up, and we need to be aware of the time that we are living. Now, Paul wrote this 2,000 years ago, and when Paul wrote this, he says, salvation is closer now than it's ever been. Now, Paul writing this 2,000 years ago, so today, if he was writing in urgency then, what does it mean about now? Just think about the world that we're living in. Just think about the so many of the confusions that we have. Like, people are confused today. And again, I don't want to offend or I don't want to assault anyone, or excuse me, insult anyone. I don't want to assault anyone either. But the confusion that we're living in, it's sometimes I'm watching the world and I'm watching society, and I'll be very honest with you, my mouth, it drops, and I'm thinking, what world are we living in? What world are we living in where we literally cannot differentiate up and down? We literally cannot differentiate left and right. And if I'm going to be very bold, we cannot differentiate a man and a woman. Like, what world are we living in? And it seems as though that society is moving towards where this is acceptable and this is normal. But we have to look at what God says. So Paul is saying that we are all asleep and we need to awaken out of our spiritual stupor, because salvation is closer now than it's ever been in the history of mankind. And that is very true. Let's go to our next verse. So Matthew chapter 24, Jesus is talking to the disciples, and he's saying, all right, guys, do you believe that I'm God? Do you believe that I'm the Messiah? Do you believe that I am the Lamb of God to come and take away the sins of this world? And it's like, yeah, we believe that. Good. Because the world is going to end. And then it says, okay, well, how do we know that the world is going to end? So now, as he sat on a Mount of Olives, and the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Let's stop right there. So if someone, excuse me, if someone comes in the name of Jesus to say that they are Christ, we are talking about a religious entity. I believe that there are things that are happening in church that are not supposed to be happening. And Jesus warns us of this. Now, just think about, trust me, I am a Christian. I do believe in God. I am I guess you could say, a religious person. I do have spirituality in me. And I believe that God does indeed have a church that will proclaim the truth and proclaim the gospel. I believe that with all my heart. But not everything is the same, because Jesus warns and says, oh, there's going to be problems in religion. There's going to be problems in church. In fact, I'm sure you probably could Google anybody who says, oh, yeah, I'm Jesus. I'm the Messiah. I'm the Son of God. So we're going to see these things happen, arise. I am the Christ, and will deceive many. So not only will people will play religion, but there are people that would follow this false religion and follow this false Christ and follow these false religious identities. We are seeing it now more than ever. Continue on here, and it says, and you will hear of wars and rumors of wars, seeing that you are not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For a nation will rise against nation, and kingdom will rise against kingdom, and there will be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in various places. All these things, and Jesus says, that's just the beginning. I believe I read somewhere that in the world, every 9 seconds, there's an earthquake. Maybe not as egregious as some, but it seems as though that, yes, we've always had earthquakes, but just the frequency of these things happening are happening more and more and more frequent. And wars and rumors of wars. I feel as though that if we go to war tomorrow, for whatever reason, I would not be shocked. Because this is what is happening in societies. And then they talk about famines. Now, here's the thing. I believe that there's always going to be poor and there's always going to be hungry until Jesus comes, because that has something to do with sin. I just believe that. But it seems as though, now, I don't know if you guys heard. Now, I'm not a conspiracy theorist or anything like that, but I do hear very smart people that I really like and I really admire says, Pastor, you need to stock up. Stock up on those beans. Stock up on corn. Stock up on rice. There's a famine coming. I'm thinking, oh, are you kidding? In America? But if you go to different parts of this world, oh, there is egregious famines. And it seems as though that this is happening. And then the Bible says pestilences. Do you guys know what a pestilence is? It's viruses that are happening rapidly. You know, where it's SARS or where it's the pig flu or where it's COVID-19 and COVID-20 and COVID-22. And now there's monkeypox and all of these variant viruses happening. And Jesus says, when these things start happening, that means the end is near. That means something needs to happen. Now, the thing is, we are living in a society now where these things could happen and we're just like, oh, it's just normal. When I was a kid, which is not that long ago, so 30 years ago, I was 6 years old, right? So 6 or 7, I remember vividly playing with other kids, playing with my friends, where we were like astronauts. You know, we were running around playing like we were astronauts, and then we would, cut out these little like cardboard, things, and we were pretending like we were like talking to each other, right? So my buddy Jerry is down the street. I'm over here, and we're like boop 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 boop. Command control, come in. You know, like we're talking like, you know, we have fake watches on. Hey, Jerry, do you hear me? We're talking like that. That was not that long ago. And here's the thing. These things are happening now where you could FaceTime and it's no big deal. You could talk on your what and it's no big deal. And in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 25, it says, and knowledge will increase at the end of time. So we are getting more and more and more smarter. Technology is happening more and more and more frequently. And the thing is, if you look at in the history of this world, for like 3,000 years, men have been riding on horses. And in the last 100 years, we have cars. And it seems like every year the cars are getting better, the cars are getting faster, people are getting smarter, people are getting more tech savvy. It seems as though that knowledge is indeed increasing, as Daniel says in Daniel chapter 7. But Jesus warns us that there is a time where we're all going to be asleep at the wheel and we won't even recognize it. It seems as though that Jesus kind of knew what he was talking about. If you think about where our world is right now, if you think about where society is right now, it seems as though that good is bad and bad is good. If you really think about it, if you have a moral compass and you want to do good and you want to listen to God and you want to do the Lord's work, you can be looked at as an enemy, a conservative, a bigot, or someone that's not accepting, or someone that's not inviting, or someone that is not loving. It's very interesting how we basically flip the script and something that is considered good and moral and holy, and we press it to the world. Oh, no, we can't accept that. That's wrong. You're not very tolerant. You're not very kind, and you're not very nice. And that's where we are today, brothers and sisters. And so here we are. Now here I am. I'm watching television, and I remember watching this program. And don't worry about which program it was. I'm watching this program, and it was like a reality TV show, and there's these two people arguing, and we're all adults here. We can talk freely. The baby won't understand. We're fine. And so it was a man and a woman arguing, and the man says, the man was saying, it was like one of those dating shows or something like that. So the man was saying, you know, if I have a penis, that means I'm a man. And the woman said, no, it doesn't. And I said, what? I'm looking and I'm thinking, this was like 5 years ago, 5 or 6 years ago. And in my mind, I'm thinking, are we in a twilight zone? What world are we living in where we cannot differentiate this and this? We cannot differentiate up and down, left or right, good or bad. It seems as though that we are living in a time of confusion. I say that if we look at out on our windows right now, we're living in the book of 2 Timothy chapter 2. We're going to go to our next verse here in 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. Ooh, I'm slipping. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4, and the Bible says, for the time will come where they will not endure sound doctrine. Think about that. So sound doctrine to me is the word of God. That's scripture. If we go to people and say, hey, this is what the Bible says, and people say, oh, no, I don't want anything to do with that. I want to do what I want to do. I want to go with what my heart says. And now if you read in the book of Romans chapter 7, Romans chapter 8, and Romans chapter 10, it says that the heart is desperately wicked above all things. Paul goes on to say, there is nothing good in me, no, not one. Paul says, for all have come short, Romans chapter 3, verse 23, for all have come short of the glory of God. That word glory is his character. There is something flawed with us, something, and it's the thing is called sin. This is why we need God, and this is why we need Jesus. But there are people that are living this life that says, oh, no, I like the way I am. Me, I'm thinking all of my flaws and all of my issues and all of my problems, I want to go to the cross and say, Lord, fix it for me. Fix whatever it is that's wrong with my mind. Fix whatever that's wrong with my heart. But the world is saying, oh, no, you're fine just the way that you are. Now, there's nothing wrong with loving yourself. Indeed, I say love yourself. There's nothing wrong with admiring your own intellect and beauty. And there's nothing wrong with that. But we're not perfect. And in our imperfection, we need Jesus. But it seems as though we live in a world that your flaws, embrace them. Where if we approach people now, they don't want to hear anything. They don't want to hear sound doctrine. And it goes on to say, but according to their own desires. Now, here's the thing. We are living in a time where our desires could be very sickening. This is why the commandments are very bold, where it says, do not covet your neighbor's wife. Do not covet your neighbor's stuff. Because here's the thing. So let's say you as a man, or me, I'll use myself as a guinea pig. Me as a man, and I see a woman that is married. And I'm like, I want that. The world will say, well, that's what your heart desires, and go and get her. But the Bible is very clear that it says your desires are sick. There's something off with you. This is why we need God. This is why we need Jesus. But no, if it feels good, then just do it. I'm thinking, oh boy, this is quite interesting. This is a school of thought that is called hedonism, not heathenism, hedo, H-E-D-O, hedonism, where basically it's, if it feels good, then do it. And it feels as though that this mentality or this school of thought has crept into our society and into our world. And I unfortunately, sadly, will say that perhaps maybe this is now starting to creep into our Christian church. Feels good, just do it. It's all about emotion. It's all about feeling. Check your brain at the door. It's all about feeling good and feeling positive. Because they have itching ears that they will heap up for themselves, the teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to the fables. The truth is very clear. The truth is very, very clear about where we are as a human condition. And the Bible gives us a very bold guidance as far as what we need to do with that. But here's the thing. We live in a world now where we don't want to feel uncomfortable.
We don't want to rock the boat. We don't want to offend the senses. So, do as you may. But the Bible says people may have itching ears. Now, here's the thing. I believe now this is something that is indeed religious. Have you ever gone to a church? Not you guys. You guys stay here, right? Amen. But you go to a church, and there is a very famous preacher that if I say the name, you guys will know exactly who I'm talking about. And he's up there, and he's preaching. And again, I don't like to criticize people or sermons. I just don't do that. But sometimes it's so off, and it makes me wonder. Preaching for 40, 45 minutes, an hour, and don't open the Bible one time. Or saying all of these good things like, you know, I don't know if you ever, no, there's nothing wrong with like self-help books in and of itself, but sometimes these sermons are starting to turn into self-help books. 7 ways to a happy life. I'm like, no, there's one way, Jesus. Or 8 ways to improve this. Or 10 ways to, and I'm thinking, wait a minute, like this is a sermon? Or is this a self-help seminar with Tim Robbins? Like, where are we here? So men will have itching ears where they want to hear things that feel good to them. They want to feed their egos. They want to hear things, yes, pacify me and make me feel good. Because sometimes the truth hurts, but we don't want to hear it. You know, medicine don't really taste good, but boy, do you need it. I feel as though in our society where if I tell you you need an open heart surgery to save your life, that is not good news for you. Wait, I got to sit in the table. They're going to cut my body open, and they're going to put another. That's not good news, but you know it's necessary, and you're going to do it if you want to live. You're going to do it if you want to be healthy. So sometimes just because it doesn't feel good going in, it's very, very necessary. Or we could say, you know what, just drink some water and go to sleep, and your heart will be fine. And in 2 weeks, you're gone. God is warning us that there's going to be a time when men will have itching ears, where men will go after their own desires and their own lusts, and they will not have a solidified mind of truth. They want to know, I want to feel good. Feed me cotton candy. Feed me a good time. I just want to feel good. Don't tell me the truth. Don't tell me things that I need to change about me. This is a time now where now it seems as though that it's acceptable. Tell me lies. Tell me truth. Or tell me, don't tell me the truth. Tell me fables. Tell me fairy tales. And we're okay with that. We are living in a time where I feel as though that we are very confused. And I believe that we're perhaps maybe confused because we turned away from the Bible and we turned away from the scriptures. But here's the thing. I believe with all of my heart that you need to be selfish. Not generally speaking, of course, we got to help and we got to lift up and we got to encourage. Don't be selfish in your life, but be selfish about one thing and one thing only. You and I, we need to be selfish about our relationship with God. Meaning there is a relationship with God that we ought to have that needs to supersede anything and everything else. Meaning if a friend says, hey, let's go do this, and you says, no, I can't. I need to spend time with God. Oh, don't worry about God, but let's go do this. Let's have fun with it. And you say, no, I need to be selfish about this thing. I need to spend time with God. Because we're living in a time where it seems as though that people are not spending time with God, and there is so much confusion and there's so much anxiety and there's so much of these negative things that are arising, and God gives us the truth and he gives us the lessons and he gives us the seed to which we need to build our faith upon. And I think it's very clear that we may not get swept up in what society is doing. And not get swept up in what the world is doing, but be selfish in our relationship with God, because there are things and entities and powers that are going to try to rip us apart from the Savior. And we can't do that. We do have a responsibility to be with God. And this brings us to, I believe, our last scripture. Ah, yes. And this is one of my favorite scriptures. It's very simple. Very simple. And it says, this is life eternal. So this is basically, the Bible says that this is how we spend eternity with the Lord. This is how we get to the kingdom. This is how we get to heaven. And this is life eternal. I'm thinking, okay, my ears are perked up. What is life eternal? And this is life eternal, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent, who God has sent, Jesus Christ, just to know him. Now, just think about knowing Jesus. Now, it's one thing to acknowledge Jesus. This is not what the verse is talking about. Yeah, I know him. I know him. No, it's a little more deeper than him. It's knowing him, but it's also having a relationship with him. It's also believing in him. And it's also following him. There are many different paths and many different decisions and many different mentalities that we have. But there's only one way to God, and there's only one way to heaven, and that is to follow Jesus, to know Jesus Christ, the one who God has sent. I think we forget that. Perhaps maybe we think that there's multiple ways to God, and there's multiple ways to heaven. Oh, if I just do this right, or if I just pay this fine, or if I just do this, well, that's good. You should do good things, but there's really one way to God, and that's through Jesus. And in the midst of this, we are living in a world where I would say is constantly on fire, where there's constant confusion and constant unrighteousness. And maybe in the midst of the chaos, we may think that it's hard to see Jesus, but no, I believe the more chaos that's around about us, the easier it is to see Jesus and who he is. So we have a decision to make. Either we can go with the ways of this world and see what the world is doing and follow suit, or we could awaken out of our sleep, awaken out of our stupor, and know Jesus, the Son of God, in whom he has sent. Let us pray together. Lord, we are thankful for your word and thankful for just giving us the time and the opportunity to unravel and to unpack and to see what is happening around about us. And Lord, maybe things are not always pleasant to hear, but Lord, we just want to follow you. Not follow the world, not follow society, not follow trends, not follow what's happening on television, but Lord, we want to follow you. And I pray that our hearts and minds are aimed towards your glory, and that we may know you, the one true God that you have sent. And Lord, for this, we are so thankful when we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Him is into my heart. Thank you.
Roar, roar, roar.
You never put your love out on the line. You never said yes to the right guy. You never had trouble getting what you want. But when it comes to you, I'm never good enough.
When I don't care, I can play him like a Ken doll. Won't wash my hair.
Thank you. with Jesus tonight. And I think you did too. So let's do it.
There is power in the name of Jesus. 3 is my worship. This is my offering. In every moment, I withhold nothing. I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it. And even in suffering, I have to believe it. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say
Come on, lift up the sound. One time.